Hi, I'm Paul Saxman, and I'm a Senior Developer Advocate at Google. In this tutorial, I'll be giving you an overview of the Google TV platform from a developer's perspective. Specifically, I'll cover why you should consider developing apps for connected TVs, I'll talk about the main features of Google TV that developers should be interested in, and I'll tell you how to get started building apps for the platform. It's a really great time for developers to start building apps for TVs because it's an emerging market. There's less competition and more room for creative ideas, and there's still time for developers to establish themselves in the smart TV space. There are a few statistics that capture where the connected TV market is going, which should give you a sense of why you should consider developing apps for TVs. The first statistic that I think is relevant is that in the US, households have an average of 2.5 people and 2.93 TV sets, and the average number of TV sets per household continues to increase, whereas the average number of people has remained relatively constant. What's interesting about the statistic is that there are, on average, more TVs than people in US homes. This also likely means that people own more TVs than other types of connected devices. This is especially true for personal devices, such as laptops, smartphones, and tablets. Another interesting statistic about TVs is that in the US, 2.92 million people own TVs and watch an average of 5 hours of television per day. Many people multitask while watching TV, so this can be shared time. However, at 5 hours average per day, television viewing is likely the top leisure activity in the US. But what about connected TVs? By the end of 2015, it's projected that more than 500 million connected TVs will have shipped. And in 2015 alone, nearly half of the flat panel TVs sold will have some form of internet connectivity. And this 500 million cumulative number does not include TVs that are sold without internet connectivity, but that are connected to the internet through a set-top box, game console, media PC, or the like. The cumulative number of smartphones sold reached around 500 million at the end of 2011. But it's definitely worth noting that smartphones have been on the market for a number of years, whereas the connected TV market is relatively new. So why develop apps for TVs? Well, a lot of people have and watch televisions. People watch television a lot, and TVs are getting smarter and better connected every day. Also, people love television, and they want to interact with it and its content in more rich and meaningful ways. We created Google TV with this in mind, and we made it an open apps platform so that developers can use their intelligence and creativity to connect with users when they're in their homes and looking to relax and be entertained. Google TV brings two open apps platforms, Android and the web, to the largest screen and the best sound system in most homes. This is Android adapted for the TV space, however, so the platform includes support for additional AV codecs and formats, protocols, and APIs that are relevant for TVs. Since Google TV is Android, it's open for Android developers to bring apps to the living room. In addition, Google TV includes Google Chrome, so developers that love HTML5 can bring their apps to TVs as well. Google TV is an open apps platform, not a device. However, there are devices available, or that are soon to be released, that run Google TV. On the left is a Vizio Stream Player and the Sony Media Player, both of which can be used to add Google TV experience to HDTVs. On the right is the LG G2 Series TV, which is a TV that includes the Google TV platform. The Google TV home screen, which is the primary user interface for the platform, has been redesigned to be more simple and intuitive, and to take advantage of several key Android features. The face in the background is live TV, which the user can bring to the foreground quickly. This area of the home screen also supports Android app widgets. Along the bottom of the home screen is a customizable quick launch bar. Here, users have access to status bar notifications sent from apps, an all apps section, the Google Play Store, and Global Quick Search. Google TV has integrated Global Quick Search, which brings search results from a number of sources to the user. In this example, you can see search results from the Google TV Programming Guide, Live TV, and the web. There are also search results from apps here as well. Any app that includes a global search provider can publish results to the user-initiated global searches on Google TV. Google TV includes the Google Play Store. If you have an app that is currently published in the Google Play Store, it may already be available for Google TV users to install. For the Google Play Store on Google TV, we feature apps that look and work great on TVs. To look great, apps should be designed for the 10-foot or 3-meter user experience. This means that text and UI's controls should be readable from 3 meters away, and that users interact with Google TV using handheld remote controls. The remote controls for the current generation of devices that support Google TV have a number of similar features, including full keyboards, directional pads, pointing devices, such as touchpads or gyroscopic pointers, a search key to access global quick search, media control keys, and the Android buttons, back, home, and menu. The directional pad, or D-pad, is a very important feature of the remote controls for Google TV. Most users prefer to use the D-pad for navigation, so developers should ensure that their Google TV apps support it. Thankfully, the Android platform includes support for D-pad navigation with standard interactive views. Developers may need to add D-pad support to custom views, however. To do so, they need to ensure that their custom views are focusable and that they show navigation focus. Google TV can also be controlled with one or more virtual input devices. This is the Google TV remote control app for Android, which is available in the Google Play Store. A version of this app is also available for iOS devices. These apps turn users' smartphones and tablets into Google TV universal remote controls, allowing them to interact with their TVs in new and unique ways. For example, these apps allow users to search for content on Google TV using voice input. The technology behind these virtual controllers is open for developers to use to build their own second screen apps for Google TV. Imagine using your smartphone or tablet as a game controller, or giving multiple TV viewers a shared experience on a TV, but allowing them to interact individually with the TV using apps on their own handheld devices. The idea of using multiple screens in the living room is relatively new, but it's quickly gaining popularity. So now it's also a great time to start building apps for the second screen as well. Now onto some lower level technical details about Google TV. This is a table of the Android screen sizes, densities, and physical resolutions. There's a lot of information in this table, but what's most important are the two cells highlighted in orange. These are the Google TV screens, which correspond to 720 and 1080 HDTV resolutions. Google TV supports two pixel densities, XHDPI and TVDPI, which is pretty close to HDPI. To support both HD resolutions, you generally only need to include XHDPI resources with your application. The platform will scale the resources for TVDPI. If you do the math, you'll notice that the density-independent pixel resolutions for both screen sizes works out to 960 by 540. Google TV is a large screen, independent of the resolution. It's not extra large, like a Zoom tablet, because TVs are viewed from much further away. It's all a matter of perspective. Google TV includes a content provider for retrieving the list of TV channels that the user has available, and supports an intent for changing channels for the user. If you want to use this content provider, you must include the Read Channels permission in your app's manifest. This content provider has the names, numbers, and call signs for the channels, as well as the URI for channel changing intent. Google TV also includes two second screen services that can be accessed on a user's home network. The first is for pairing personal devices with Google TV so that the devices can securely send information to the TV. The second is the AnyMote protocol, which allows devices to send key events, mouse events, such as movement and clicking, basic string data, and URIs for starting intents. Whichever app is in the foreground will receive the key and mouse events, so you can use the AnyMote protocol to build companion apps for phones or tablets that interact with Google TV apps. These protocols form the foundation of the Google TV multi-screen experience. Java and C++ libraries that implement these protocols are available online, open source, so the developers don't need to start from scratch when building second screen apps that integrate with Google TV. The Google TV remote app for Android that I mentioned earlier uses these protocols and is available open source as well. Due to the 16:9 aspect ratios of HD televisions, a horizontal left-to-right layout works better on Google TV than the vertical top-to-bottom layout that is commonly used for phones and tablet apps. To help developers implement a horizontal layout, we've released a left navigation bar Android library. This library includes a class that extends the Android action bar class, so that you can use it exactly like you would the action bar. The only difference is that it draws itself vertically on the left-hand side of the display instead of at the top. Google TV includes an Android location provider, But location works a little bit differently on Google TV than it does on Android phones and tablets. To access the location provider on Google TV, you must include the course location permission in your manifest, which is for non-precise coordinates, and to retrieve a user's location, you need to use the static location provider. The location that you get from the location manager is only accurate to the postal code level. Users are asked to enter their postal codes when configuring Google TV for the first time, and they can re-enter the information at any time using the system settings. You should therefore only use the postal code portion of the address associated with the coordinates returned from the location provider. To start developing apps for Google TV, you'll need to install the Android SDK tools. And if you'll be using the Eclipse IDE for development, which is recommended, you'll need the ADT plugin for Eclipse. Once you have the SDK tools installed, you can run the Android SDK manager and install the Android 3.1 SDK package for developing Google TV apps. Documentation for installing and using the Android development tools can be found on the Android Developer website at developer.android.com/SDK. For testing your app, the Android SDK tools includes a hardware-accelerated emulator that you can use in conjunction with the Google TV add-on that is part of the Android 3.1 SDK package. It can also help to use a real device for testing apps for Google TV. An Android tablet in landscape mode with a USB or Bluetooth keyboard attached will allow you to test your layouts and D-pad navigation. However, you should definitely consider getting a Google TV device for development. It could definitely make the difference between building a good app and a great app. And finally, the Google TV's developer site is the best place to go to get started with building apps for Google TV. Be sure to visit the site at developers.google.com/TV before you dive into coding. This site includes documentation, design guidelines, community resources, and sample code that should definitely help you build your app. And that's everything for this tutorial. If you have any questions, please feel free to reach out to the Google TV team on Google+. Our Google+ page is Google TV Developers. Thanks for watching.